Good morning. Welcome to the Cathedral of Mary, our Queen, especially to those who may be visiting or joining us through our webcast. This is the 14th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Mass is being celebrated today by Father Bianco. Our first hymn this morning is 1086, This Is My Song, number 1086 in the hymnal. Please stand and join us as we begin our celebration.
This is my song, O God of all creation, a song of peace, the lands afar and mine. This is my home, the country where my heart is. Here are my hopes, my dreams, my holy shrine. But other hearts in other lands are beating, with hopes and dreams as true and high as mine. My country's skies are bluer than the ocean, and sunlight beams on clover leaf and pine. But other lands have sunlight too and clover, and skies are everywhere as blue as mine. So hear my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for their land and for mine. This is my prayer, O Lord of all earth's kingdoms. Your kingdom come, on earth your will be done. Let Christ be lifted up till all shall serve him, and hearts united learn to live as one. So hear my prayer, O God of all the nations. Myself I give you, let your will be done.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Just want to begin by saying how happy, how blessed I am to be here with all of you as your new rector. I have great joy in my heart. I'm going to say more later during the homily time, but I just want you to know how delighted I am to be with all of you. So for now, brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, Only Begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, You take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son has raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. As the Lord spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard the one who was speaking say to me, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have revolted against me to this very day. Hard of face and obstinate of heart, are they to whom I am sending you? But you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord. And whether they heed or resist, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that a prophet has been among them. The word of the Lord.
Our psalm refrain is, Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy.
Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord,
his mercy. To you have I lifted up my eyes. You who dwell in the heavens, behold like the eyes of slaves on the hand of their lords. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. Like the eyes of a servant on the hand of her mistress, so our eyes are on the Lord our God, till he show us his mercy. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy. We are filled with contempt. Indeed, all too full is our soul with the scorn of the arrogant, the disdain of the proud. Our eyes are fixed on the Lord, pleading for his mercy.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, that I, Paul, might not become too elevated because of the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, an angel of Satan, to beat me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. I will rather boast most gladly of my weaknesses, in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore, I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and constraints for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong." The word of the Lord.
Sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus departed from there and came to his native place, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What kind of wisdom has been given to him? What mighty deeds are wrought by his hands? Is he not the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his native place and among his own kin and in his own house." So he was not able to perform any mighty deed there, apart from curing a few sick people by laying his hands on them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. The Gospel of the Lord.
I forgot how long of a walk that is. Again, how happy and blessed I am to be here with all of you. I see many, many, many familiar faces, but since I left years ago, there are many new faces. So, for those who don't know me, I'm Father Louis Bianco, the new rector here at the Cathedral. For the past 7 years, I've been pre-secretary to Archbishop Laurie, and before that, had various assignments in parishes as associate. But for the first 4 years as a priest, I was associate pastor here at the Cathedral from 2005 to 2009. Over these past few weeks, so many people have said to me, "Welcome home. Truly, this is home for me." A first assignment always holds a very special place in a priest's heart. I want you to know that I have prayed for all of you as Cathedral parishioners every single day since I left in 2009. And I hope you feel that this is your home too. This is your spiritual home. We are a spiritual family. And Father Goff and I will strive to be the very best spiritual fathers that we can be for all of you. The clergy and I will do everything in our power to help you in any way that we can. We want to encounter the Lord with you. We will always promote the good, the true, and the beautiful, because you deserve that. I'm happy to be working alongside of Father Goff, Deacons Fritz and Senft, and the entire staff of the Cathedral Parish and School. There's some significant changes here. We have two new priests, a new director of music, and I appreciate that change is difficult. It's difficult for us who are new, and it's difficult for all of you. And so I ask for your patience, but most of all, I ask for your prayers. It's all a bit overwhelming for me right now, these past few days, but I say if I could survive 7 years with the Archbishop, I could pretty much survive anything. And I could say that here because that's something I would say to him, and it's okay. So again, so happy to be with all of you and to serve you. It is a privilege to serve you. I thought on my first weekend here that I'd see how the readings might apply to this unique situation. A new rector, but going back to familiar territory. So I turned to the first reading. We heard the Lord say to his newly appointed, "I am sending you to rebels who have rebelled against me. Hard of face and obstinate of heart are they to whom I am sending you." I wouldn't call too many of you rebels, although I see a few of you out there who I think are a little rebellious, so scrap that idea. So I went to the second reading. St. Paul says, "I have received a thorn in the flesh. A thorn in the flesh has been given to me." Kind of batting 1,000 here with the reading. So I moved on to the gospel. And in the gospel, we heard that Jesus returned to a familiar place, but he was not able to perform any mighty deed there. Strike three. So I scrapped that idea. But really, what the readings are pointing to this weekend are the theme of Jesus being rejected by those who know him. He's gone back to Nazareth, back to his hometown, to the local synagogue in order to teach and to preach. Jesus' first homily, so to speak, was met with anger and rejection. I certainly pray that I don't offend too many of you today with this homily. But the reason people didn't accept Jesus was because they knew him well. They knew his humanity, and so they thought, how can he do all of this? And even though Jesus was performing miracles, the people couldn't get themselves to believe in him because of their lack of faith. Now, this is a parallel with the first reading, in that Ezekiel was sent to a rebellious people who would reject him also. In fact, Ezekiel's mission was to preach to a rebellious town, the town of Jerusalem, which had become depraved, gravely sinful, and to be rejected. God told him that he would be rejected. And it would be those same leaders of Jerusalem that would condemn Jesus and hang him on a cross. Not the same people, because Ezekiel lived centuries earlier, but the leaders of Jerusalem rejected Ezekiel, and the leaders of Jerusalem rejected our Lord. And so we see this parallel between the two. The world, all these 2,000 plus years later, still rejects Jesus and the truths that he came to preach. But the world doesn't reject only Christ. The world also rejects those who come in his name, those who are called to be witnesses of the truth. We are called to be those witnesses. By virtue of our baptism, we share in what is called the tre munera, or the threefold office of Christ. As Jesus Christ is priest, prophet, and king, so we too are all priests, prophets, and kings in some way. We are prophets in that we're called to preach and to teach the faith in all that we say and do. We have this mission from God by virtue of our baptism. We might face hostility and rejection just as Jesus and Ezekiel did, but we have hope. In the second reading, St. Paul describes this burden placed on him. He said he was given a thorn in the flesh. Whatever that thorn was, he asked three times for it to be taken away. God rejected that request, and he said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." So we should never be afraid, because the grace of God is sufficient for us. So if we're willing to fight for the truths of our faith and courageously live as true disciples of Jesus Christ, God will give us his grace always. We just have to be open to it. So let us not be afraid to take up this mission entrusted to us. God's grace is sufficient for us, in the good of our families, the good of our communities, and really the good of the entire world depends on us as being true disciples of Christ.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We have all gathered here, dear brothers and sisters, to celebrate the mysteries of our redemption. Let us therefore ask Almighty God that the whole world may be watered from these springs of all blessing and life.
For all of us gathered in this sacred place, by faith and devotion, and by love and reverence for God, let us pray to the Lord. For God's holy church, planted as a sign of the kingdom in the midst of the nations, let us pray to the Lord. For this country and for every nation, that all people might enjoy the blessings of peace and liberty, let us pray to the Lord. For an end to the scourge of racism and ethnic hatred, which divides the human family, let us pray to the Lord. For the earth, our common home that God has given to us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord. For all who are in trouble, sorrow, or need, for the unborn and the elderly, the refugee and the prisoner, and for those who seek to care for them, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and the dying, especially those around the world suffering in this pandemic, and for all healthcare workers and medical researchers, let us pray to the Lord. For eternal rest for those who have died, especially Nadia Morgan, for whom this Mass is offered, and pleading the intercessions of Mary, our Queen, together with all the saints, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May your mercy, we beseech you, O Lord, be with your people who cry to you, so that what they seek at your prompting, they may obtain by your ready generosity, through Christ our Lord.
Our offertory hymn. 912 in the hymnal.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. Where there is doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in you and we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, his assistant bishops, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ, for the kingdom. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Corpus Domini, Jesu Christi, custodiat anima meam, in vitam aeternam.
Our communion hymn is number 819 in the hymnal. Eye has not seen. 819 in the hymnal.
Eye has not seen. Ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of When pain and sorrow weigh us down, be near to us, O Lord. Forgive the weakness of our faith and bear us up within your peaceful world. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love him. Spirit of love, come and give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. Our lives are but a single breath. We flower and we fade, yet all our days are in your hands.
so we return in love what love has made. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. To those who see with eyes of faith, the Lord is ever near, reflected in the faces of all the poor and lowly of the world. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. We sing a mystery from the past, in halls where saints have trod, yet ever new the music rings to Jesus, living Son of God. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come and give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you, through Christ our Lord. Please be seated for a moment. I had my chance to introduce myself to all of you, so now I would very much like for Father Justin Goff and Julie Grace Males to introduce themselves to you.
Good morning. My name is Father Justin Goff. I am your new associate pastor, and to echo Father Bianco's words, I am overjoyed and grateful to the Lord and to the Archbishop for this assignment, my first priestly assignment in a parish. I was ordained in this cathedral church on August 22nd last year, the Feast of the Queenship of Mary, and I've spent the past year in Rome finishing up my licentiate in sacred theology. I'm a native of Baltimore. I grew up in between Parkville, Towson, and Lutherville. My parents, Lisa and Jerry, still live in Lutherville. I'm their only child. And they worked very hard to put me through the best Catholic high school in the area, which is, of course, Calvert Hall. I realized I may have just made a few enemies, but aside from Thanksgiving, I think we can get along just fine. Really, at Calvert Hall and at my home parish, Immaculate Heart of Mary, I discerned my vocation to the priesthood, and I look forward to sharing that story with you in a future homily. And it was through music, service, just being involved in the parish and in Catholic life that I felt the Lord was calling me to be a priest. And so I entered the seminary right after high school. Archbishop O'Brien appointed me to go study in Providence, Rhode Island, where I did my philosophy at Providence College. And then Archbishop Lori asked me to study in Rome for theology, which I've done for 5 years. I am very grateful, as I said, to be here, to be your new associate. I'm excited for this opportunity. I'm excited for all that the cathedral is to the Archdiocese of Baltimore, and I'm excited to get to know this community in a deeper way. My first time here was for the organ recital when it was rededicated in 2007, and I remember getting here early and kind of wandering around and just being amazed at the beauty of the place. That my sense of amazement has not left, although I didn't much care for the organ recital. I play the organ as a kind of hobby. The recital left a lot to be desired, but this cathedral has always impressed me and always held a special place in my heart. And now I look forward to getting to know the beauty that resides in the pews and all of you. So I promise to be the best priest that I can be, to strive every day to be a better priest, a better disciple, and a better spiritual father for you all. Please keep me in your prayers. I thank you for when I fall short of that. And please know that you have been in my prayers and will continue to be in my prayers in the weeks and months and years ahead. Thank you. God bless you.
Good morning. My name is Julie Grace Males. I have two first names, kind of like Marianne, but Julie Grace. My father was called Julie. His name was Julius. My mother was Grace. So those were already taken. Perhaps I look unfamiliar, and my name is unfamiliar to you as well. But know that this beautiful space, the Cathedral of Mary Our Queen, is not unfamiliar to me. I have been in Baltimore for the last 5 years, serving Archbishop Lori as the director of the Office of Divine Worship. So I have been here working with Father Bianco for all of the archdiocesan liturgies behind the scenes. And in the last year and a half, I have also been the director of music for those liturgies. I also graduated from a high school that is Catholic, and I doubt that anyone is going to get very excited about it. But at the last Mass, there actually was one person who had heard of it. I graduated from Central Catholic High School in Lafayette, Indiana, home of Purdue University. Has anyone heard of that? It's kind of a generic name. Anyway, I was born and raised in West Lafayette, Indiana, as I said, home of Purdue University, though I graduated from Indiana University Conservatory of Music, and I also have graduate degrees in sacred music and liturgical theology. I am will be working with both Father Bianco and Father Goff, who, as you know, are both professional quality musicians, so they will be keeping a very close eye on me. I am coming, as they have said, feeling very honored, very privileged to be part of the community here. I come not to change things, but to get to know you well, to listen to you about which repertoire is familiar to you, to find out even more about what is beautiful in terms of music and in terms of prayer, and to build on that. So I look forward very much to getting to know you. I was raised in a cathedral parish in Lafayette, and to tell you the truth, I've been a little bit homesick in the last 5 years that I've been here. So I'm hoping maybe you'll agree to adopt me as a member of the cathedral here. In Lafayette, I later, although I was very involved in music ministry from a very young age, I later became the director of music there, the director of diocesan music, and worked for the better part of 20 years as the director of the Office of Divine Worship. So again, looking forward to getting to know you, to listening to you, and to worshiping together. I don't know if you're aware of this, but the most important instrument in the Roman Catholic Church is actually not the organ, it's the voice of the assembly, so that we sing as one, praising the Lord and bringing forth the kingdom on earth. I look very much forward to doing that with you. Thank you so much.
So you can see part of the reason why I'm so excited to be here at the cathedral with these wonderful staff members. On behalf of Archbishop Lurie, Father Goff, our deacons, the entire staff of the cathedral, parish, and school, I wish you a very happy 4th of July holiday. I hope it is a very enjoyable, relaxing, and safe day among family and friends. Please stand. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Our recessional hymn is America the Beautiful, 1087 in the hymnal. That's 1087 in the hymnal.
Nobleness and every wane dear.